get your Bibles and want to stand with me for the reading of God's Word. Brother Chris, you can just play softly behind me if you want to. That's all right. You can help me tonight. Hebrews chapter number 4. I want to begin reading at verse number 14. You know, the Lord has a way of letting you know you're on the right track.
Yeah.
Amen. You come in a service sometimes and you just say, is that it? And then something will be said in that service. The Lord will confirm that word.
Yeah.
There's some of you in here tonight, you really need a touch from the Holy Ghost. I know this is a great crowd on a Friday night. Listen, folks, I ain't used to preaching to big crowds like this on Friday nights. Man, we were over next to home Monday night. God knows my heart. Emily was there. I preached just as hard to about 15 or 20 as what I will to you tonight. But you know why? Because it doesn't matter whether there's 15 or whether there's 200 here tonight. Somebody's in need of the presence of God. Somebody needs something. You wouldn't be here if you didn't have a need in your life. And I believe he's come by to help us tonight. How many believes that? I said he's here to help us tonight. Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 14. You have it, say amen. The Bible says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Somebody say infirmities. But was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. That's a game changer right there for you and I. And he said, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace. We could stop right there and run with that, but I want to read it again. We're going to go on. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Listen to that last line of this scripture. He said, to help in time of need. I wish somebody said, my help's in here tonight. I said, my help's in here tonight. As your hands and hearts lifted to the Lord one more time. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for what you're doing right now. We ask God that you give us to receive. Open our mind, open our spirit, and let us have an ear to hear what the Holy Ghost would have us to hear tonight. In the mighty and the glorious name of Jesus, and the church shouts amen. And amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise as you're being seated in his house tonight. Hallelujah. Thank God for what we have as an inheritance, as the children of God. If we really knew who we were tonight, our approach in this world will be much different many times than what it is. Because we tend to be a people that just go based upon a feeling. I come to tell you tonight that the Holy Ghost that we have is more than just a feeling. That what we have is more than just an emotion. Now don't get me wrong. I'd much rather you be up here shouting and dancing and running these aisles than sitting and looking at me like a cow to new gate. Trust me. I appreciate your worship. And I'm thankful for that tonight. But we have to understand and know that what we're doing in this house is not based upon flesh, and it's not based upon what we can see in the natural, because we have to understand and know that what's taking place in the spirit is more real than what's taking place in the natural. That what we cannot see, that what we cannot understand. I mean, those right now, there's something going on in this house. There's something taking place. You and I cannot see it. You can't look at it with natural eyes. For the Bible teaches us that we're to walk by faith and not by sight. It's through the Spirit. It's through what we know in the Holy Ghost. I can't tell you who you come on. I just know a few, maybe a few faces in here tonight that I've met along the way. Know some folks back there, been in some of our meetings before. But as I don't know any of you in here tonight, but yet the amazing thing about what we've come to do is that while the Spirit of God begins to move during the worship, and while I'm preaching to you tonight, the amazing thing is that what I'm preaching, the Holy Ghost is individually dealing with every heart in this house tonight concerning your need. The Bible says that he will perfect those things that concern us. lives. Meaning that the will of God for you is that you understand that you have a helper, that you have a friend that's just closer than a brother, that you have a very present help. Come on, somebody. Bible says God is our refuge and strength and very present help. Somebody say he's a help. He's a help in trouble. Philippians 4:19 says, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Now tonight, the Holy Ghost knows what you have need of. He knows everything about you. He knows your uprising. He knows your down setting. He knows that he's got the bare hairs of your head numbered. There's nothing about you because you are beautiful and you're wonderfully made. He knows that, but come on, I've come to find he doesn't always leave on my wants, but he is very well in the pursuit of moving for my needs because he knows what I have need of. You see tonight, you have something in you. There's an aortic valve that's inside your body. You've got a heart and that heart pumps blood. But if you were to sever that aortic valve, it doesn't matter what kind of a good heart you have, you're going to fall dead. Come on, somebody. Come on, you've got carotid arteries that go to your brain. But if something happens to those arteries, come on, it doesn't matter how smart you are. It doesn't matter what kind of an education you have. It doesn't matter what kind of degree you've got on the wall. You sever those carotid arteries and you're going to fall like a dead man. Meaning tonight that those arteries and those valves are the supply to the heart. It's the supply to the brain. And the Holy Ghost says, I want to be just that for you. I don't want to just be your 2 minute, 2 hour, 3 hour Sunday. I don't want to just be your emotion. I want to just be a cheer bumper or a booster. I want to supply your need. I want to be the best source and the very reason you live, the reason you move, and the reason that you have not been. I wish somebody tonight would shout and say to me, he is my everything. He said, my God shall supply. The supply, as the blood flows to the brain, as the blood flows to that heart, it supplies the need. And tonight there are needs in here that you don't even want anything, anybody to know anything about. We come to church and we sit on our pew and we sit beside folks. Nobody knows what's going on in our mind, and nobody knows what's been going on at home, and nobody knows what you've been dealing with that nobody knows anything about. Come on now. We come in here and we pray and we lift our hands and we're in the fight for our life. We come and we're in a battle, we're in storms. And there's some of you here tonight that are really in the fight for your life. You've come here not to just get another message. You didn't come here tonight just to hear another song. You came tonight because you need a move of the Holy Ghost. I come to tell somebody tonight, Holy Ghost has come to meet you in this house, in this moment, after this hour. Don't you reach your hands and thank him that he's moving for him. The Spirit of the Lord. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, I mean, there's liberty.
Yeah.
Meaning there's freedom. What is it about the enemy that wants to fight us and wants to come against us?
Come on,
amen. That's a little better. Come on, the enemy wants to fight us and wants to come against us because he doesn't want you in the presence of God. He doesn't want, come on, the enemy doesn't care if you come to church. You can sit on a pew and be miserable and just absolutely just come here and just go through the motion. But it's another thing when you make up your mind, I'm getting in the Spirit and I'm going to get my help. And I'm going to receive what the Holy Ghost has for me. Come on now. I said the enemy doesn't want you in the Spirit because he knows when you get in the Spirit, chains are going to fall off. And when you get in the Spirit, come on. I said when you get in the Spirit, the enemy begins to back up
Yes.
And he begins to move. Come on, how many believe you? Yes. You get in the spirit. That's why the scripture says, therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. Come boldly. Come on, how many knows that when we are in the time of need, when we're in the time of desperation, it's when the enemy fights us and he makes you feel like you're unworthy and you don't have any place in God. He makes you feel as if, come on, anybody ever felt unworthy? Anybody ever felt like you wanted to go pray but you couldn't pray? Anybody ever went to your prayer closet and you couldn't get prayed through because you felt like there was something there hindering you? Well, of course there was something there hindering you, because the enemy knows that the moment you get in the presence of God. I said he knows the moment that you begin to enter into worship, the moment that you can, come on, the moment that you break past this barrier of flesh and this thing that stands in front of you. He knows that sickness cannot stand in the presence of God. He knows that depression cannot stand in the presence of God. Come on now. I said he knows that if you get in the spirit, that the Holy Ghost is going to tear down walls, and he's going to break down chains, and he's going to stop it. So the enemy knows. The moment that you get in the spirit, and the moment you get in the presence of God, that your help is on the way. That's why Romans 8 says that there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And he went on to say, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. And the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Come on, somebody ought to shout tonight, I am a child of God. The place where the devil hits you is, he says, you ain't saved. He says, you ain't filled with the Spirit like you thought you are. Come on, anybody ever had the devil tell you that? Anybody ever had the enemy say, come on, I remember I was 16 years old, got baptized in the Holy Ghost, and the very next day I was in high school in the locker room looking in the mirror, and I heard a boy speak to me and said, you didn't get what you thought you got last night. Come on, for a moment, I just about come unglued, but all of a sudden there was something rose up in me. Something rise up in me, and I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that there's more than just this little boy right here. Come on, I'm a child of God. I'm an heir of God, and I'm a joint heir with Jesus Christ. I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God. Somebody give him a shout of praise. And he went on to say, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. He said our infirmities, not that infirmity means a weakness. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searches the heart knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. I don't know about you, but you have to know that your answer is in the Spirit, that your help is in the Spirit, that your deliverance is in the Spirit. That's why the Lord said the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto me, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the open of commandment. I said the Spirit of the Lord would come upon us. The Spirit of the Lord would not just come upon us, but he's Christ in you, the hope of glory. I said he's Christ in you. Somebody lay your hand on your heart and say, he's Christ in me, the hope of glory. I've got life and living in me. I've got the anointing abiding in me. I have truth of the Holy Ghost living on the inside of me. Come on, he's not just some God that's a far off. He's a God that's at hand. Come on, honey, he's right here. And he's here right now. He's here for the needs of his people. He came here just for you. And the Lord said, I want you to come boldly to the throne of grace, especially in the time of need. And the enemy pushes against you, and he says, you ain't worthy. The enemy says, who do you think you are? What business do you have? Come on, it's when you're in the greatest need of your life that there's a voice coming out of the Spirit saying, come unto me, all you that labor and that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. For unto me, my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. I hear a voice saying, don't you let nothing stop you.
Come on.
Don't you let nothing hinder you. Don't you let nothing defeat you. I don't know about you tonight, but if we're filled with the Holy Ghost, we've got the name of Jesus. We've got the blood of the Lamb. We've got everything we need to put one foot in front of the other and declare it's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit. So the Holy Ghost, you've got everything you need to destroy the earth. You've got everything you need to break every chain and deliver the victory in the name of Jesus. Somebody give him praise. What's y'all's closest hospital around here? What's the closest hospital? Y'all got one, don't you? Amen. Y'all live so much by faith, you don't even need a hospital. That hospital's closest one. All right. But if you were in that hospital tonight, and you were on the, come on, back home in our little hospital, if you're on the third floor, you're doing pretty good. Come on, third floor means you're going home in about a day or two. Come on, if you're on the third floor, you can have a visitor anytime you want. If you're on the third floor, they'll bring you flowers, put them in the window. You got a little button and you'll hit it, and about 15 minutes later your nurse might show up, and again she might not, who knows. Come on, when you're on the third floor, come on, they're not so much worried about you. But if you're on the fifth floor, that means you made it to the ICU, and when you're in ICU, you got bells and whistles all around you. You got wires and hoses and tubes, every bit of this. Come on, they ain't concerned about whether you got the TV on prices right. They're not, no, no, no. Come on, you're there because you're in critical condition. You're there because something's wrong. You're there because there's some sort of trouble. Come on, you don't even have to worry about hitting the line to get that nurse to come in and see you. They're on the other side of the glass, and they're watching your blood pressure, and they're watching, come on, they're watching it. They need you make. They make sure you got your medicine. They make sure you got everything you need. Why? Because it's a very critical time. Yeah. Hey, there's not a call. You're against it. It's never been. Brother, when you're in so much need that the Holy Ghost says, come on now. Come on, it's when you're in trouble and the enemy says, God's forsaken you. It's when you're in the battle and the enemy says that you're all by yourself. I come to tell you that when you're in the greatest trouble and you're in the greatest need, you've got a call. It's checking to make sure you're all right. He's checking on. Ain't got any nurses in here. Come on, any nurses in here? One in the back. Come on, you checking that pulse. You checking the blood pressure. You checking they run the fever. Cough, mister. No, don't cough. I'm just saying. Come on, it's a constant watch. And the Holy Ghost says, I'm watching you. Come on. Yeah, it makes you feel like you can't enter in. I come to tell you tonight, I don't care how low you are. I don't care how much trouble you're in. I don't care what the enemy says. I don't care if the devil's told you no 1,000 times a day. All you need is one yes from the presence of God. And demons have to pray. All you need is a go ahead from the Holy Ghost and the train from the police. And the miracle solution is good. For the Spirit helpeth our infirmities. He helps our weaknesses. He knows that you're weak. Come on, you're not a strong guy, but in the flesh, every one of us are weak. Right. Come on, how many knows the Spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak, and the Lord knows you're weak, and He knows your weakness. Come on, I said He knows where you come up short, but He doesn't just stop because you don't have it all put together. Because I don't have it all put together, I don't have all the answers. I can't tell you how to fix everything. I can't. Come on, anybody ever find themselves in situations that you don't know how you got there? Figure out how it happened. Come on, you're laying there flat on your back, wondering, how did I get here? Come on, I come to tell you tonight, you may be like that man that fell among thieves that was going from Jericho. But how about to miss somebody? Your God's not like that Levi, and your God's not like that priest. Your God's like that good Samaritan. And when He sees you polluting your blood, and He sees you laying there half dead, He's going to pour in the oil and the wine, and He's going to bind up there. Get you on your knees and thank you. Come on, somebody. I said the Holy Ghost has come tonight to find your bones and let you know it ain't over until God says it's over. You ain't finished. You're not done until the Holy Ghost has come.
That's the truth.
I'll shut that up.
I said, you got help. You got help in here. Come on, if I pick up 50 pounds with this arm, but all I can do is pick up 10 pounds with this arm, I'm not going to pick up that 50 pounds with this arm and expect me to do with this arm what I know I can do with this arm. But the Lord says, go ahead and try it. Go ahead and give it a shot.
Yes.
Go ahead and see what you can do.
Hey.
Because I found that the Lord will allow me to do some things. The Lord has allowed me to attempt some things.
Hey.
He's allowed me to give it my best shot. But when I gave it my best shot, I still came up short. And when I gave it everything I had, I still fell flat on my face. But the Lord said, I'm going to have to let you be there. I'm going to have to let you realize that when you've done all you can do, I'm going to step in and be for you what you don't have the ability to be for yourself. But come on, somebody. You can pick up 50 pounds of this arm, but when you realize I can't do it, all of a sudden that Christ in you will come in and help you. And come on, somebody. Hallelujah. I'd rather glory in my infirmities than the power. He knows you can't do it. He's got that down. He's not going to throw you out because He knows you can't do it. He said, but if you'll do what you can, I'm going to step in and do for you what you don't have the ability to do for yourself. I'm going to do it for you. And when you pick up 50 pounds with a 10-pound, come on, strength, all of a sudden you say, oh, come on, you say, I know it's not in me, but I can do all things through Christ.
Yeah.
I can do all things through Christ. And the enemy says, you can't get it. The enemy says, you can't do it. But I hear the Holy Ghost say, you can heal him with boldness. You can heal him with authority. I come tonight to let the devil know I'm here in the authority of Jesus' name. And there's nothing that the Lord can do to stop me when I've made up my mind. But I've done all I can. I've given it everything I know how to give. Come on, anybody feel like you're right there right now? Come on, somebody. Anybody feel like you're there right now? You've given everything you give, but it ain't been good enough. But then the Lord steps in. I said the Lord steps in, and He begins to help you in your infirmities. He begins to, you see, tonight the difference between us and every religion of this world is that, come on, some would say that we're all just climbing the mountain and we're all going to the same place and we're all just trying to get to the same God. Well, that may be the case for them, but the difference between us and them is that your God come down off of the mountain and He came to where you were because He knew you didn't have the strength to do it on
the Lord. Hey, come on, somebody. I said God wrapped himself in flesh and came down to this earth and walked among us. He made himself of no reputation. I came in the form of a servant. Hey, come on, somebody. I said he's Emmanuel and he's God with us. He walked with us. John said in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word called somebody. And the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh. We beheld his glory as the Lord of us. We beheld his glory as the Lord of the power of God. For the grace and truth, I come to let you know that your God has come down to you. Your God has come to you. You know you must say, your God has come to you. You know the source of your God. Nobody else could do. He came down. I said he came down. And what drew him here? Why'd he come? Just like John chapter 4 said. And he must needs go through Samaria. Because there's a woman coming to that well who's got more needs than you can shake a stick at. She's got... Oh, come on, somebody. I said, there's a woman coming to that well every day. She's drinking of that same water, but she's getting the same results. Come on, anybody? Anybody know what the definition of insanity is? Doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. Come on, this woman keeps coming back to that well. But there's something this day that her need has drawn to mind. And by the time she gets to that well, by the time she gets to that well, the master's sitting on that well, and he's sitting there waiting on her to get there. Come on, we can go into depth of what happened at that well. But all I know is that she'd been through the first man, the second man, the third man, the fourth man, the fifth man, and Jesus looked at her and read her like an open letter. And he said, woman, he said, the one you got right now is not even your own. You know why? That woman came down that day. She'd met the first man, the second, the third, the fourth, and the fifth, and she was on the sixth. But this day she met the seventh man. And when you meet, hallelujah, when you meet the seventh man, you can never be the same. When you meet the seventh man, hallelujah, I say he knows. Because he knows what you have need of. He knows what you're going through. It was her need that drew him to that well. And tonight, you thought you just come to church. You thought you just showed up for a Friday night, one night revival meeting. And all of a sudden, you walk through these doors, and the Spirit of the Lord said, I know what you have need of. He said, I know what you've been struggling with. I know, come on, I know what kind of mind battle you've been fighting that you don't want nobody to know anything about. Because if they thought, come on, if somebody here knew what you're thinking right now, they wouldn't think you're as holy as what you want them to think you are. Come on, somebody. I said, they wouldn't know. If you knew what was going on in the mind, if you knew what was going on in your mind, you'd say, oh, they'd think I wasn't saved. Hey, but the Bible says Jesus came up out of that Jordan River and the Spirit drove him into that wilderness to be tempted of the devil for 40 days and 40 nights. And the first thing the devil did was he came to him and he said, if thou be the Son of God. If you really are who you say you are, turn these stones into bread. Oh, but man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Don't you find it strange that nowhere else in the Bible did it say that the devil came back and said, well, if you can't turn them stones into bread, why don't you try this one? No, sir. He didn't come back the third time and say, why don't you take this stone and turn it? No, he moved on to something else. He said, come on. He takes him up on that pinnacle. Takes it. Come on, we know the story. We know the three temptations that we know about in that wilderness. But the devil realized that once he spoke that word, and once he come on now, he said, if you really be the Son of God, if you really are who you say you are, come on, when he realized
that it couldn't get him to turn the stone to bread, he moved on to something else. And when Jesus said it is written, the devil moved on to something else. I come to let the devil know tonight, I may be in the battle, but I know who I am. I may be in the storm, who I am. I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God. I'm saying yes.
At the moment you take the word and you stick it in the devil's mouth, he moves on because he realizes he's got me defeated there. And there's, come on now, do you realize that before somebody holds your Bible up? Come on, before there was a written word, there was a spoken word. Come on now. Everything that was made and created was made by a spoken word. When there was nothing, God spoke and creation came into existence. Before there was a written word, there was a spoken word. But the reason God gave you the written word is so that you could speak the same word that was spoken. And when you speak that word of God, come on now. I said when you speak that word of God, there's power and there's authority and there's an anointing. Come on now. I said there's a how many still believes that they speak the word of God with boldness? And when they speak the word of God with boldness, lame legs begin to walk, and deaf ears begin to hear, and the dead was raised. I come to tell you, if you'll speak that spoken word under the boldness of the Holy Ghost, the devils begin to tremble.
For 40 days and 40 nights, he returned in the power of the Spirit.
In the power. Come on, I don't know about you. I've come to find most of the time, now I'm going to speak for myself. I've found that most of the time, sometimes I can pray, sometimes I can, I mean, it feels like God's right there in the room. Most of the time when I pray, I have to go put my war clothes on because it's a fight.
Amen.
And it's a, come on, you know why? Because we're against a veil of flesh. And until you tear that veil of flesh down, you can't enter into the Spirit. Come on, somebody. Jesus was on the cross and he said, "It is finished." And when he said it is finished, he gave up the ghost, and the veil of the temple was rent from the top to the bottom. And it wasn't just so the high priest could go back there. It was so, come on, it was for an oil from the head of convict collar to go into the very presence of God. It's some of you in here tonight that you could go into the presence of God. And the Lord said, if you can get past yourself, and you can get past your own mentality, and you can get past that barrier. Come on, Joshua. The Lord spoke to Joshua and said, "As I was with Moses, so shall I be with you." He said, "Wherever you put your foot, I'm going to give it to you." Come on, that's what he said. But when they came down to that Jordan River, the priests, the feet of those Levites, they were carrying the Ark of the Covenant that housed the very presence of the Lord. And when their feet touched the water, the Jordan stood up on a heap. I got to thinking about that here a little while back. And the Lord said that what they were carrying is what carried them over. That what they had in their possession is what gave them the power to overcome where they were, to go where the Lord was directing them to. And sometimes you have to realize, if you're waiting on something else to come, it ain't coming. If you're waiting on some next big thing to happen, it ain't happening. He's Christ in you. Amen. The hope of glory. Because God don't live in a box. Come on, God don't live. Oh, sir. Come on, in actuality, this ain't nothing but wood and stone and brick. Come on, this right here where we're at tonight. Come on, I was down in Alabama preaching last year. I preached a couple of night revival, and the next week the church burnt down and it's all gone. Come on, I have to start a fire, but not that kind of fire. Come on, everything you see right now, it can be gone in the matter of a moment. But if I lose everything I have and I still got Jesus, I've got everything I need. If I lose the floor, have him. I have everything I need. Because Jesus said in John 15, he said, I'm the vine and you're the branches. He said, a branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine. And Jesus said something that really turns my world upside down. He said, for without me, you can do nothing. Oh, don't that deflate our religious mindsets. Don't that burst our bubbles. He says, for without me, you can't do anything. If you don't have me, because he said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, he said, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. You hear me? Because when your will becomes his will, then you can ask what you will. Come on, y'all hear me tonight? I said, when your will becomes his will, then you can ask what you will. I'm going to come back to the piano. I'm going to tell this, and I'm opening this altar. I heard a little story here just recently. It moved my heart. And this story talked about a man who had everything you could ever imagine. I mean, I'm talking about so rich. Come on, he don't even know it wasn't Donald Trump either. Come on, somebody. He's just a rich man. Rich man. I told somebody the other day, I said, when I grow up, I want to be like Donald Trump. I don't want to be president. I just like to have a little bit of money. Come on, somebody. Anyway, this man had everything you could ever want. Some of y'all get that later. This man had everything you could ever want. Money. Had a large estate, land, possessions. And this man had one son. This boy, he liked it with everything. I mean, this was his boy. Everything that man owned was going to go to that boy when he died. Something happened, and that boy fell sick. His sickness got the best of him, and the boy died. This man was so broken. He was so hurt over losing his son. Didn't know how to deal with it. Didn't know how to cope with it. So he brought in this gentleman who was a painter to paint this humongous portrait of his son. And this painter painted this mural. It was large, this great big painting. And this man hung it up in the great room of his estate just so he could sit every day and look at that picture of that boy. Weeping, grieving, broken. Years went by. And this man fell sick. And after he fell sick, he died. And had nobody to give all of his possessions to. Nobody. There was nobody to inherit all this land and money and this estate and all these possessions. So it all fell into an estate sale, into an auction. And people from all over the country came just to gather in to buy this man's possessions. He had everything you could ever want. And people gathered in that room that day, and the auctioneer got to sit down at the table, and he dropped his gavel on the table. He said, we'll begin the auction. He said, we'll start, first of all, with this portrait. This is a portrait of the man's son. And they brought it out, and they set it up on an easel. And everybody looked at it. He said, we'll begin the bidding. All of a sudden, nobody bid on the picture. Nobody wanted it. Nobody desired it. Nobody cared. Moments passed and moments passed. The price kept dropping and kept dropping. And finally, there was a little widow woman on the back row lifted her hand. And she said, I'll take the portrait for 1 shilling. And the auctioneer dropped the hammer on the table and he said, sold to the lady in the back row. They carried that big portrait down that aisle, handed it to that little poor widow woman. Everybody's waiting on the next item up for bid, and that auctioneer drops the hammer on the table, and he says, the auction is over. And they said, over? What do you mean it's over? What about the estate? What about the land? What about the car? What about all these things? And the auctioneer said, the man has written that he who gets the son gets it all. Come on, now. I don't believe you really understand. I said, he who gets the Son gets it all. I come to tell you tonight, if you've got Jesus, you've got everything you need. If you've got Jesus, you've got a friend that sticks closer than a brother. If you've got Jesus, you've got a very present
love you, Lord. I need you. I need your presence. I need your anointing. I need your spirit. I need you to help me. You're the only thing I have. But you're everything I need. Come on, somebody talk to him in this house tonight. Oh, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Oh, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Come on, he's supplying somebody's need right now. He's helping somebody right now. If you're here tonight and you're lost without God, if you're here and you're not saved, I come to this altar and I have to push somebody out of the way to get to this altar. I come right now. Come on, I wouldn't hesitate and wait another moment. The Spirit has come tonight to help you. I said the Spirit has come tonight to help you. And whatever you're going through, and whatever you're up against, listen, if you're here and you're lost, you're away from God. This altar is open for you first and foremost. I'm going to ask, can I get some of you men? I don't mean to move the altars. That's not my intention. We just got a lack of space. Can we set these altars just up on these steps? And let's open up this floor, because here's what I'm going to do. Come on, I want the preachers, and I want the ministers of God that's in the house tonight to line up here in the front. Come on, line up. And even if you got to line up on two sides, come on, quickly, preachers, move quickly.